So, with Stalin in charge of the Soviet Union by 1928, one of the key things, if not the key thing, that he wanted to do was to modernize the economy. He famously said, "Either we do it or we'll be crushed." He felt that the Soviet Union was still 50 to 100 years behind the advanced industrial nations of the West, behind Britain, behind France, behind Germany, behind the United States, and that if the Soviet Union was going to survive, it must modernize economically. So that's what he set about doing. And the two methods that he used to do it were, number one, the collectivization of agriculture, and that was to finance the second method, the industrialization of the country. Lots of historians have likened his economic policies to a second revolution. The first revolution in 1917 might have enabled the Bolsheviks to take political power and establish their control over the country. But from 1928 onwards, there was a second revolution, arguably, an economic revolution of the country. And it was a revolution from above. It was a revolution to establish Soviet command of the economy. And indeed, it created a command economy. The first aspect was the collectivization of agriculture. And really, the main idea of collectivization was to finance the industrialization of the country. The idea was that any profits made but in the countryside wouldn't go to the peasants who were on the farms, but would go to the government that would enable them to invest in machinery and in the industrialization drive. Any surplus grain that was produced, any surplus food that was produced, could be exported, and again, that would give the country foreign investment that they could use. And any surplus people working in the countryside could also move into the new industries, new towns, cities, new factories. So the whole purpose of agriculture from 1928 onwards was secondary, was subservient to the needs of industry. And the way Stalin and the country went about doing this was to collectivize agriculture. And what that meant was that peasants no longer owned their own farm or their own farming business, but all farms were pooled and put together in one great big collective. So you might have a village that had, say, 20 different farms on it. All those farms would be merged and put into one big super farm, and those farms would be controlled by the state, basically. The idea of this was that it would enable economies of scale, because if you have one big super farm instead of 20 different little farms, then you don't need 20 people running the farms. You don't need 20 different sets of machinery. You don't need lots of each individual farm having whatever equipment they need. Instead, you just need a central set of machinery and equipment, and the surplus people can go and work in the towns or in the cities, in the factories. Another benefit to the Soviet Union or to the party, as Stalin saw it, was that it would impose communism on the countryside. It would seek to smash the kind of capitalist instinct that peasants had of their own profits or their own property or of their own business. And instead, it would make all of those kinds of impulses secondary to the needs of the state. And it would, well, the idea was that it would eradicate those kinds of impulses amongst people and impose socialist or communist ideas. One of the things that went along with this program was a return to a sort of a propaganda that had happened during the Civil War, the demonization of the so-called kulak class of peasants, peasants who were suspected of hoarding grain, of looking after themselves, enriching themselves at the expense of others. And so the state sponsored a pretty violent anti-kulak campaign, provided local villagers with banners saying, "We must smash the kulaks as a class, we must identify them and drive them out of the countryside." And so there was a lot of violence that went along with the imposition of collectivization. that, you know, the violence that was directed towards these so-called alleged kulaks. Between December 1929 and March 1930, nearly half the farms in the Soviet Union were collectivized, which is an incredible feat within 4 short months for so many farms to be forced into these collectives. But it was met with massive resistance in the countryside. The peasants hated this being done to them, hated the loss of their own business, their own identity, their own profits. And so there was massive resistance across the countryside. Lots of peasants, rather than cooperate and give up their food or their livestock to the state, they slaughtered their animals, they destroyed their crops, they burnt their own farmhouses down rather than giving them up and having them merged into the collective farms. But of course, that just made the situation even worse because it made it even harder to produce food, and it meant there was even less food to go around. And food supplies fell dramatically by the spring of 1930, so much so that there was a temporary pause in collectivization in the spring summer of 1930, but then it resumed again at the end of 1930. But the problems continued throughout the 1930s. Peasants were so resistant to collectivization that the amount of food produced and the amount of animals in the country declined dramatically. And of course, but any food that was produced or, you know, any livestock that was reared was all for the benefit of the cities rather than people in the countryside. And it was forcibly taken from the peasantry to the point where they literally didn't have enough to survive. And it caused mass starvation in the countryside, and it caused a famine. It caused a man-made famine in the countryside. And it was particularly bad in the most fertile regions of the Soviet Union, in areas of the Ukraine and Kazakhstan. In Kazakhstan, for example, something like 90% of the livestock was lost through resistance to collectivization. People just didn't have enough to eat. And there are horrific stories of, you know, corpses littering the street because people are just dropping dead from starvation. And there are horrific stories of cannibalism because people, you know, were driven demented by their hunger and, you know, resorted to you know, such extreme measures. But in a sense, as far as Stalin was concerned, it was successful because peasants left the countryside because of conditions like that. Peasants left the countryside and they went to work in the towns and cities. They went to work in the factories. And so it did provide that workforce that Stalin wanted for the industrialization drive. And the industrialization drive to him was key to modernizing and strengthening the country. So, whilst it had a horrific impact on the people of the country, as far as Stalin was concerned, from a kind of political point of view, it was successful in that it imposed his ideas on the people and it provided the labor force that went to work in the factories. By the end of the 1930s, virtually all farms in the Soviet Union were collectivized. And then in the early 1940s, the Nazis invade, which caused another huge disruption. I mean, it's just a total, complete understatement to say it caused a huge disruption in the countryside. But life for the peasants had been so tough in the 1930s that when the Nazis invaded in the early 1940s, many in the Russian countryside actually greeted the Nazis like they were liberating them. They were pleased to see the Nazis. That's how bad it had been for many in the Russian countryside. And then for the next 4 years during the Second World War, more horror and disruption for the Soviet peasant. After the Second World War, they hoped that there would be a relaxation for them, but there wasn't going to be any of it. There was more of the same after the Second World War. Stalin carried on with the same plans, same goals for the economy, and now the new enemy after the Second World War was the capitalist West, and the Cold War was developing. And so the country still needed to be vigilant and still needed to be strong. And collectivization carried on in the countryside as well. As well as collectivization, there was also the industrialization drive, and the whole purpose of that again was to strengthen the country, to enable the defense of the country. And the way the Soviet Union went about it was to establish a series of 5-year plans for industry. During Stalin's lifetime, there were 5 of these 5-year plans, and that includes the period of disruption during the Second World War between 1941 and 1946, where there wasn't a 5-year plan for industry, but the country was just on a war footing, a war economy footing, where everything that was produced was for the defense of the country and to fight the war. But other than that, there were 5 5-year plans during Stalin's life. But to call them a plan is a bit of a misnomer, really, because they didn't really set out detailed plans about how to organize the economy. It was more a case of setting targets and of setting quotas. And the emphasis of the 5-year plans was on the heavy industries. It was to produce more iron, more coal, more steel, more electricity, more chemicals, because Stalin regarded these as crucial to the development of a modern industrial economy. He said that these were the kind of bedrock of modern industrial economies. So there were huge targets and pretty unrealistic, wildly unrealistic targets for the production of oil and coal and steel, etc. And there were, during the 5-year plans before the Second World War, there were enormous increases in the quantity of these goods produced. There were massive increases in the amount of electricity produced, in the amount of oil produced, amount of iron produced. But for the workers that were required to, work in these industries and work in mines and work in factories, living conditions were appalling. There was no provision made for a massive influx of new workers into towns and cities and factories. There was certainly nothing like any kind of health and safety legislation or anything like that. And people were expected to work long hours in poor conditions. Housing and sanitation was poor. People lived in overcrowded apartment blocks, or they lived in kind of huts. They lived in virtual shanty towns in some of the new industrial centers that sprang up in the 1930s. The most famous example is a place called Magnitogorsk, which means magnetic mountain. By the late 1920s, it was a small village of about 25 people, but by the late 1930s, it was a huge new industrial city of over a quarter of a million people when new factories and new mines had been built. But there was no infrastructure for the benefit of the people. People were living in huts and shacks and, without running water, having these appalling living conditions. Another big feature of the industrialization drive is that the quality of goods that was produced in the Soviet Union was notoriously poor. There was an emphasis on quantity rather than quality, but the quality of things that was produced was very, very poor. There was virtually no production of consumer goods for people, things that the everyday Russian would need. The emphasis was all on the heavy industries, and the state was constantly exhorting its people to work harder and harder. And the most famous example of this came from the Stakhanov movement of the 1930s, from 1935. A worker in a coal mine called Alexei Stakhanov apparently mined a huge amount of coal in one shift, and he was held up as an exemplar to the rest of the Russian people. You too can be a worker like Stakhanov. You should be like Stakhanov. Posters were produced with his image on, statues were produced of him. He was given perks for being such a productive worker. He was given a car, he was given better accommodation. And the ordinary Russian worker was, encouraged to be like Stakhanov. It later turned out that it was all a complete fraud because Stakhanov had this huge team of people that had helped him on this legendary shift that he'd worked, where he'd produced all this this amazing amount of coal. But this was typical of the kind of propaganda that the state was producing to encourage people to participate in the industrialization drive. It wasn't all imposed on the people, though. There was a certain amount of enthusiasm for it as well. Certainly, younger workers, a lot of them actually participated willingly in the industrialization drive and believed that they were creating a new kind of country. That in the West, in the 1930s, the Great Depression had taken hold and the economic model of capitalism seemed to be failing. But in the Soviet Union, they were building a new kind of economy. They were building a new kind of communist economy, and it was being successful with these amazing increases in the output of the heavy industries. And we also have to remember that this was in the 1930s. It was in the international context was the rise of Nazi Germany and the increasing aggressiveness of Nazi Germany. And arguably, therefore, Stalin's insistence on building the heavy industries was going to be crucial so that the Soviet Union would be able to produce the stuff that it needed at a time of war. And in fact, the third 5-year plan was focused almost exclusively on the material that was needed for war. Then the Nazis did invade in 1941, and the Soviet Union fought this massively destructive war from 1941 to 1945, but the Soviet Union won. And arguably, they were only able to do that because of the industrialization that had taken place in the 1930s, because they had the industrial base that enabled them to produce enough tanks and enough planes and enough artillery and all the other material of war that was needed during those 4 years. What else can we say about industrialization? For the workers, life was probably as hard at the time of Stalin's death in 1953 as it had been at the time of the Bolsheviks coming to power in 1917. There were few consumer goods. A lot of the goods that were produced in the Soviet Union were of poor quality, but they had industrialized. The country was now more of an industrial one than an agricultural one. And they'd survived and defeated the Nazis. And in 19 and after the Second World War, the Soviet Union was a superpower. Arguably, none of that would have been possible without the industrialization drive of the 1930s. There are some other aspects of Stalin's control of the economy that give an indication of the way he controlled the country politically as well. Anyone accused of attacking his management of the economy or of being opposed to his management of the economy, that's what I mean, was accused of being a potential wrecker or a spy or a saboteur. And that's a classic example of how he used opposition to his policies but to his own political advantage. And that's what I'm going to talk about in the next film. His political control of the Soviet Union in the 1930s that went on during this period of economic expansion.